Good morning. I welcome you all towards a session on system software. What is system software and why should we require it? We heard that we are going to have a couple of programs in C, and we wanted to know how exactly the program we write works into a computer. For this, we need a basic understanding in system software. Can I have some examples of system software? Yes. Assemblers, loaders, linkers, compilers, and operating system are good examples of a system software. Now, why should I have all these system software? Initially, whenever we wanted to have things that happened using a human being towards a machine doing all those things, we went on for some kind of an automation. Say, for example, turning on and off of a light usually was done by a human being. Then we wanted to make it automated. Suddenly the invention was a switch that had two states, that is 0 or 1. That is, initially whatever was done by a human being was said to be done by a machine. That machine understands only two literals, that is 1 and a 0. So, if we can code all your knowledge in terms of ones and zeros, the machine can understand whatever you say. So, if you wanted to switch on this lamp, I would straight away say 1, by which the machine would start to glow. If I say 0, it would start to turn off the entire lamp. So, if I could demonstrate every of my knowledge in terms of ones and zeros, the machine can very well understand. But it is often hard to code every of my knowledge in terms of ones and zeros. So this is where the evolution of programming languages picked up. To start with, they could not code every of their information in terms of ones and zeros. So they had it in some other platform which was not either in terms of ones and zeros or into a normal colloquial language as like English. So they wrote all their information into a low level language, what they call as an assembly language program. So they have their codes in an assembly language program, which is created by the user. And then it has to be converted into a machine code, which could be understood by a machine. This is a poor little machine that can understand only ones and zeros. But you have written a program in assembly language which is somewhat other than ones and zeros. So there needs to be a translator which can translate this assembly language program into machine code or an object code. I name this translator as an assembler. So, an assembler is a system software that takes in as input a source program that is written in an assembly language, and it converts the entire source program towards a machine language. This is the main functionality of an assembler. Now, what are we going to understand in this entire narration? We will have a basic on, basic assembler functions. Then, we will have a few features of assemblers discussed, that is, we have machine dependent assembler features and we do have machine independent assembler features. Once we get across this, we will have a small discussion on how these assemblers are designed, and we will try to understand the different assembler design options. This would be our interest while we discuss assemblers. Now to start with, what are assemblers? What are their fundamental functions? Assemblers are something that translate mnemonic operational codes towards their machine equivalent or machine language equivalents. It assigns machine addresses towards symbolic labels that we make using our program. What are symbolic labels? Every statement in that assembly language program would have, can optionally have some labels. These labels have to be transformed towards their machine equivalent addresses. So this is also a function that is being done by an assembler. I repeat again, an assembler eventually translates mnemonic operations towards machine language equivalents, and it also assigns machine addresses to symbolic labels. Then you might ask me something about machine dependency. What is machine dependency? Different machine instruction formats and codes depend on machines. That is what we do call as machine dependency. What is the purpose of having a program? That is an assembly language program. This program is intended to read records from the input device. It copies them to the output device. At the end of the file, it writes an EOF on the output form. Then it can make use of some subroutines. What else can it do? It can have data transfer. It can either read data or it can write data. For this purpose, we make use of a buffer. A buffer is used to store all these records. Buffering is necessary for different I/O rates. The end of each record is marked with a null character. The end of each file is indicated by a zero length record. Within the program, you may have subroutines. You may have some subroutines like JSEB and RSEB, which we will elaborate in brief while we proceed. Then there are something which are noted as assembler directives. These are pseudo instructions. These are not ever translated into machine instructions. These provide information towards assemblers. I said an assembler will convert an assembly language program towards a machine code. But there are some instructions which are not translated into machine instructions. Rather, they provide information towards assemblers. Can I have some examples of basic assembler directives? Yes. Examples are start, end, byte, word, reset bit, and reset word are examples of the various assembler directives. I will come again. The basic assembler directives are, I can have start, which marks the beginning of my process. I can have end. I can have byte. I can have word. I can have the same thing like RESB, that is for reset byte. I can also have some RESW, which is something like reset word. Making use of all these things, making use of mnemonics, making use of this assembler directives, I can create a program. It can have a header, it can have a text, and it can have an executable thing which constitute an entire assembly language program. Let us not get into inner depths of how to have an assembly language program done, because we are just interested in knowing what an assembler is and what are the functions of an assembler. Now looking at the functions of an assembler, the first and foremost function is to convert mnemonic operation codes towards their machine language equivalents. It then converts symbolic operands to their equivalent machine addresses. It builds the machine instructions in a proper format. It converts the data constant to an internal machine dependent representation. It is interested in writing the object program and then the assembly listing. These are the basic assembler functions. Then, how do I design an assembler? An assembler is done in two different passes. That is, in pass one, in a two pass assembler, what I can do is, in pass one, I would assign addresses to all statements within the program. That is, every statement in the program is given a proper address. Then I would try to save the values assigned to all labels, which is going to be made use in the later pass two. And then I would like to perform some processing of assembler directives. I told you just before that your program may consist of the pseudo codes. You may have your assembler directives and you can have your labels in your program. In pass one, we try to perform some processing of these assembler directives which are listed across this. Then, if these are the things that are going to happen in pass one, what is going to happen in pass two? Pass two consists of all assemble instructions. It consists of a way as how to generate data values defined by these bytes and words. It performs processing of assembler directives that are being not done in pass 1. I told you that some of your assembler directives are getting processed in pass 1, and there are a few assembler directives which may not have been processed in your pass 1. All those are reserved for processing in pass 2. Finally, it writes the object program and it creates the assembly listing. This is how a two-pass assembler works. Okay, we have a design. Then what are the data structures that support this design? The data structures that support this assembler are, you have something like an op tab, which is named as an opcode or an operation code table. Then you have symbol table, that is the place where we store all the symbols that we make use in your program. Finally, we have another structure called as LOC CTR, which is for a location counter. This keeps in track of all your addresses. I repeat again, the various data structures that help us in assemblers are, number one, op tab, which is for operational code table. Then I have sim tab, which is for your symbol table. And number three, I have a location counter, which counts the addresses. Now moving on towards an op tab. What is going to be there as the content in your op tab? It contains mnemonics, it contains machine codes. For example, it consists of something like the instruction format and the length of the particular instruction. What is its characteristic? It is always a static table. You can have inferences out of it. That is the main use of having an opcode tab. Then, how can I implement this? As I said, this is going to be a static table. I can create it out of either an array, or it can be done across a hash table, which is more easier for performing a search. Now moving on to the next data structure, that is sim tab, that is a symbol table. What is going to be there stored into this symbol table? I can store label names, I can store values, I can store the flags that I have made use in my program, and these are going to be the contents in my symbol table. What is the characteristic of this table? Unlike your op tab, this sim tab is going to be a dynamic table. That is, as and when the user makes use of something, it is going to be inserted, it is going to be deleted, or it is going to be searched out of this symbol table. How can I implement this? As I said, it is a dynamic table. I can make use of hash tables, or I can make use of non-random keys, or I can make use of hash functions to create this sim tab. This is what I make use in sim tab. Then moving on towards assembler design. Assembler design has, I mentioned towards, machine dependent and machine independent assembler features. Now, which features of your assembler happen to be machine dependent? The instruction formats and the addressing modes happen to be machine dependent. So is your program relocation. These are features which are more bothered about a machine. Then, can we have examples of machine independent assembler features? Yes, we can have. You can have literals, you can have symbol defining statements, you can have expressions, you can have program blocks, and you can also have control section and program linking. All these things do not worry much about the machine features. So we call all these to be machine independent assembler features. Then how does translation happen? A translation happens with respect to registers and then with respect to addresses. The register names like A, X, L, B, S, T, F, PC and SW can have some values like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8 and 9. These are getting preloaded into your symbol table. Then how does address translation happen? The most important thing, most register memory instructions use program counter for relative or base relative addressing. What are relative and base relative addressing? Once you get into the addressing modes of a particular assembler, you can very well get to know about these constructs. Then, there are very many addressing techniques used for program relocation. What is program relocation? A need for a program relocation happens whenever we cannot go ahead with absolute addresses. All the addresses other than absolute addresses need to be modified. It is not an immediate or it is not a memory address. It may be a PC relative, that is a program counter relative, or a base register relative addressing. The only parts of the program that require modification at the load time are those that need a specific or a direct address. Then, what is a relocatable program? You have some program which may not be of a direct addressing, which needs some relocation. Say for example, you have different columns in the entire segment. You say in the very first column that I need some modification by specifying that the first column is M. The columns from 2 to 7, that is, it tells you the starting location of the address field to be modified. To what relation should it be modified? That is also being specified over here. That is, it holds something like starting location of the address field to be modified relative to the beginning of the program. Say for example, I should say that the beginning is at 3000. I want to have it relatively shifted towards 20 more addresses. So the addressing strategy starts from 3020, and the 20 gets added with every of the addresses that you have been previously allocated. Then the columns 8 and 9 would have the length of the address field to be modified in half bytes. This is how we do try to have the various relocations done. Then we have some more machine independent assembler features. They range from literals, symbol defining statements, expressions, programming blocks, control sections in a program, and finally linking. All these features happen to be machine independent. So this is a wide introduction about assemblers and how assemblers translate a given assembly language program towards a machine program or a machine code.